email. What a pain that ended up being. Huh? You ever had that friend that writes really long emails? You open them up, you feel like you got homework. I can't read this dissertation now. I'm going to keep that as new. I never even read them half the time. I just hit reply, sounds good. Don't write back, ever. It is amazing how email has changed our lives. So you ever get a handwritten letter in the mail? You're like, what the hell? Has someone been kidnapped? Well, I'm not opening it. It's probably filled with anthrax. Email has definitely made sending regular mail a chore. You're like, what, I stuck in an envelope? Now I got to go outside? What, am I a triathlete here? Work, 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 work. I do love how informal email is, but then when I have to write an email to a smart person, I get all tense. Great, now to be sure this is a complete sentence, I guess I'll capitalize a letter or two. That's a symptom of being lazy when you can't quite reach the shift key. They get the idea.
At 7:07 at WRJN, I'm Don Rosen. Thanks for joining us. Hometown Radio Refreshed, a civic media station. Nell Minow, the movie mom, is joining me right now. She's a movie critic. You can watch her reviews on Facebook. And I guess your website, what's the website called? Is it moviemom.com?
It certainly is. All right. Easy to remember.
Yeah, I read them on Facebook when you post them there. And you've been doing that movie critic for how long now? Many, many years, huh?
Since 1995, yeah.
Wow. Yeah, but you've been a movie fan all your life, I assume.
I was. I was the movie critic for my high school and college papers, and then I went to law school, did other things for a while, and when the internet started, 1995 was really like the Fred Flintstone era for the internet. I was one of the first people ever to write a movie review online, and soon enough, by near 2000, the internet had happened, and Yahoo asked me to be their movie critic, and I started writing books about movies and going on the radio. So yeah, it's been a blast.
That's so good. It's like the Fred Flintstone era. That's good. A good analogy. And so we're going to talk about the Academy Awards. And here's something the Oscars woke up to a couple of years ago. Their viewership was going down because they used to nominate five movies, four of which nobody ever heard of before. Because
right.
they didn't play at local theaters. They were more art house films. And they got their run in maybe New York City, Chicago, L.A., but the rest of the country never got a chance to see them. So then someone came up with a brilliant idea. If we make it 10 movies, we'll get some popular movies in there too, which won't get the Oscars anyways. It doesn't matter. But at least we'll get people rooting for their movies when it's on television and they can watch the Academy Awards. Kind of a smart idea when you think about it. So that's why we have certain movies in this list here. But it's still a list of major unknown movies.
Well, that's because the movies come out, a lot of them, at the very, very end of the year in order to qualify for Oscars, and they hope that the Oscar nominations will get people interested in them. So movies like The Holdovers, maybe you might have said, well, I don't know, but once you see that Paul Giamatti's been nominated and the film has been nominated, the screenplay's been nominated, maybe that will get you to go see it in theaters. But fortunately, it's already streaming. I think just about everything that's been nominated is already streaming, and so you can stay in your house and watch them all.
What do you think about movies that appear, you know, from they don't play in theaters originally. I think you have to stick them in a theater in New York and L.A. for, what, a week or two?
Yeah, that's right. Those rules were made for a different era. And I have to say, as I always do when we talk about awards, that remember, the Oscars are nobody's idea of the ultimate arbiter of quality. That's the industry voting for themselves. And that's why a lot of movies that employ a lot of people in Hollywood, like the Lord of the Rings movies, get awards because they're big. And they often say the Oscar doesn't go for the best acting. It goes for the most acting. So I think you have to just take it with a grain of salt, look at some of the other awards. Of course, the Golden Globes are always fun. They've had some controversies over the years. I'm a voter on the Critics' Choice Awards. Now, I think the one advantage of those awards is that we actually see everything, which the Oscar voters don't. And it's not our industry, so we vote, I think, more objectively. But even at the Critics' Choice Awards, in order to engage the audience, they added a separate category of, you know, best film that everybody actually likes. And Barbie won this year.
You know, it's funny you mentioned it's people basically patted themselves on the back with the Academy Awards. It's kind of like Congress voting themselves a pay raise.
Yeah, or a teacher grading their own exam. Yeah, absolutely. But like, we don't watch the Oscars. We watch, you know, for sort of the way we watch the Super Bowl. It's for the fun of it and then the next day, I think everybody sort of forgets who won.
Let's talk about some of these best pictures, because I know you like the movie American Fiction.
I do. That was my favorite movie of last year.
Yeah, I read that. So what's that about?
It's based on a book that came out around 2000, and it's about a black professor who's very, very frustrated because he wants to write about classical literature, and they keep putting his books in the black part of the bookstore, and he says, I'm writing about ancient Greece. You know, I'm trying to write about different things, and you're just really, it's very reductionist. And he gets so angry that he writes a parody of a terrible book, and it becomes a huge success. Jeffrey Wright, one of the best actors ever, is just tremendous in the role. It is the sharpest of satires, but it laughs at itself as well as everybody else, and just a powerhouse ensemble cast, including Tracy Ellis Ross and Sterling K. Brown, who got his first Oscar nomination for it, and first-time writer-director, who just really knocked it out of the park. I read the book when it came out almost 25 years ago, and I couldn't imagine how they would make it into a movie, but they did a great job.
Okay, going down in alphabetical order, Anatomy of a Fall. Now, this one I never even heard of.
Well, that's because it's not an American film. I'm going to say that I didn't love it as much as everybody else, so keep that in mind. But it's about a woman who is accused of her husband's death, and the only witness is their child, who is visually impaired. So that makes him not the most reliable of witnesses, aside from the fact that, of course, he's emotionally very involved. And the movie, I'm just going to tell you right up front, even though there's a long courtroom scene, this is not Perry Mason. You're not going to find out. I have my own views about what really happened, but a lot of people really like that movie. I have to say it did not work for me all that well.
Sounds good, though. Sounds like a good premise. Yeah, things that sound good aren't always good.
Yeah.
Let's go down the list here. Barbie, now one of the most popular movies of the year. And I didn't see the movie. It's not my cup of tea. But I heard it was fantastic. The people who saw it wanted to see it again and again.
I loved it, and I thought it was very funny, very smart. I think it was 100% true what the marketing slogan was for the movie. It said, if you love Barbie, this movie's for you. If you don't love Barbie, this movie's for you. Ryan Gosling, I know everybody, you know, is mad that Margot Robbie didn't get nominated, but Ryan Gosling is amazing, as he always is in this movie, as Ken. And in a way, Ken is the most interesting character in the movie because he's so frustrated not having anything to do except sort of be around whenever Barbie wants him. And I thought it was fun to look at, entertaining, very smart, really interested to see what writer-director Greta Gerwig is going to do with the Narnia series, which she's taking on next.
So now, in a way, Margot Robbie did get nominated because she's one of the producers of the movie. So if it does win Best Picture,
she will definitely get an Oscar. Yeah. And by the way, she's sometimes, as you know, and producer doesn't mean anything in Hollywood, but sometimes it means everything. And in her case, it really does, because it was her idea. She negotiated the deal with Mattel. She's the one who brought in Greta Gerwig and Noah Baumbach to write it. And, of course, she plays Barbie. So it really is her movie.
You know, sometimes you'll see the credits. You'll see like 50 executive producers, and there's like a nonstop list, and that's everybody who gave 50 cents to make the movie.
Well, not only that, I mean, it's somebody's cousin that they just want to get a credit. It's ridiculous. The producer credits are absolutely nuts, but in this case, she really did bring this one in.
And it's not fair to the people who are actually doing the work.
Yes, you're absolutely right.
Okay, the next one is a favorite. I'm hearing nothing but good things about this, The Holdovers.
I just loved it. And if you saw Sideways, it's the same director and the same star. Paul Giamatti gives one of the great performances of all time as an angry, bitter professor of classics at a boys' school, a boarding school, where the kids are entitled wealthy white kids from 1970. And it's about what happens when he is required to stay there over the Christmas holidays with the boys that are not able to go home. And it goes somewhat in the way you might think, and somewhat it will surprise you, and I just loved it. And as I said, that one is streaming now, and so you can watch it at home.
Paul Giamatti will always be Howard Stern's boss to me in Private Parts.
We won't say what they call him in that movie, but he is fantastic in that movie.
When he finally unloads on Howard Stern in that
goodness,
film.
Oh, my goodness. That is one for the record.
When he just loses his temper at him.
And he's so great, of course, in Sideways. I am not drinking Merlot.
He also was in a movie about magicians, and I forget that there were two movies that came out at the time, and he was in one of them.
Yeah. He was, I forget which was which myself, but yeah, if you look back over his career, you can just see how many great performances he's given. He's in a movie that no one's ever heard of that I absolutely love called Cold Souls, about an actor who's having a hard time with his role, and so he puts his soul, he has it removed, and it's about what happens when he has to work without a soul, and it's very smart, very funny, very offbeat movie.
Let's see if we can get this in before we have to break here. One of my favorite films of the year. I know it's long, but it felt like it was just a half hour. It was that good. Killers of the Flower Moon. Excellent movie.
Brilliant film, and you know, a lot of times you just don't think a movie ends well. I thought the ending, one of the all-time best, up there with Godfather 2. Brilliant acting, you know, Lily Gladstone for sure, going to get the Oscar.
Fabulous, fabulous performance.
Yeah, just and tremendous, just the production design. I want to point out that was also nominated for an Oscar. Jack Fisk, who happens to be married to an Oscar winner, is, I hope, going to get the Oscar for that, because the way they created that town is incredible. So, yeah, he met Sissy Spacek when she was working on a movie with him, and they've been happily married for many years.
You know, and performance is great all around. It's a murder mystery is what it is. And
yeah.
Robert De Niro, Leonardo DiCaprio, but Lily Gladstone is just, I mean, I can't tell you too much because I don't want to ruin the picture for people, but it's like, it's a long movie. Killers of the Flower Moon, but it's excellent. Hold on. We're talking to Nell Minow, the movie mom. We're talking the Oscars, the nominations, movies, everything. It's all right here at WRJN Radio. I get so excited when I talk about movies. And we'll talk about the first movie I ever saw, and I want to ask Nell if she remembers the first movie she ever saw. It's coming up shortly right here at WRJN Hometown Radio Refreshed, a civic media station at 7:19 on your Wednesday morning. I'm Don Rose. Nell Minow, the movie mom, is here. We're talking about the Academy Award nominations. Our next one on the list, Nell, is a film that was actually made for streaming. And I don't think it had a wide release. It's Maestro, starring Bradley Cooper, who also, I think, produced the film. It's about Leonard Bernstein. And wrote it. Leonard Bernstein, he plays.
And directed it, yeah.
Oh, yeah, he did everything. I mean, he's one of those people now that it's just took off. It's like the guy from the TV show The Office, who played Jim on The Office. Now he's one of the great directors of suspense horror movies. So tell me about The Maestro.
Well, it's the story of Leonard Bernstein, one of the towering figures of the 20th century. And it's interesting to me that we had three movies come out at the same time about figures who were real-life major, major figures of the 20th century, and all three movies focused on their love life, and that's really what's true with Maestro. Now, Leonard Bernstein was gay, but he also was very, very deeply in love with his wife, a woman, played by Carey Mulligan, and it's about the ups and downs of their relationship. I thought there were moments of absolute brilliance in it. I thought it was uneven, but the opening scene, there are a couple of scenes in the middle, a marital fight that they have in their apartment while the Macy's Thanksgiving Day parade is going on outside. You can see the balloons going by as they're fighting with each other. Some of the, you know, great performances, of course, every note of the music by Leonard Bernstein. There's a scene where Bradley Cooper studied for 6 years to conduct a Mahler piece, and it's just tremendous. So there's a lot of great stuff. It's on Netflix. You should definitely give it a watch.
Yeah, how do you feel about that? I was going to ask you, how do you feel about Netflix movies and Amazon movies being thrown into the Academy Awards?
You know, I think the pandemic really accelerated it, but I think it was going in that direction anyway. Those movies are great movies, and I think they should be considered. I love to see a movie in the theater. I would always rather see it in the theater, but in fact, some of the best movies out there are being produced for streaming.
You know, I was shocked the other day. I went to go see The Boys in the Boat.
Oh, yeah.
Which I really loved. When the MGM logo came on at the beginning with the roaring lion, it said an Amazon company underneath it.
I know.
I mean, I know. I was like, now I couldn't concentrate on the beginning of the movie.
Yeah, I know. Well, I used to feel that way when they was it Columbia that said a Gulf and Western company, and I mean, you know, and for a while one of the big studios was owned by a Japanese company. That's just the way of the world, I'm afraid.
I think Columbia came on as a Coca-Cola company at one time because Coca-Cola owned Columbia.
Yeah, it just makes no sense. That's why, you know, you want to look for things like A24, which is an independent studio, and they just keep, you know, knocking it out of the park. They're just great.
And what was the other one? It was Warner Brothers, an AOL company.
Yeah, yeah.
But when I saw an Amazon company, I was, and, you know, my wife is watching, probably couldn't care less about it.
I know.
It shocked me when I saw that. And
I felt, what would Louis V. Mayer say?
And I even said on the air the next day after I saw the movie, I said, he's probably doing somersaults in his grave right now.
I know, but it's a great movie, Boys in the Boat, directed by George Clooney. Highly recommended.
Excellent movie. By the way, before we leave Maestro, I've told this story on the air before. My dad stood on Leonard Bernstein's toilet seat.
Okay.
He was fixing a pipe in the building. He worked for a company, and they repaired pumps for skyscrapers. And the problem was in his apartment right above the ceiling. So my father was standing on his toilet bowl. Leonard Bernstein was sitting on the rim of the bathtub talking to my father for about 25 minutes about my brother's band. This is back in the 60s.
That's amazing.
And he said the guy was white pants, white sweater. He had a white grand piano in his apartment. It was magnificent. And this guy sat on the rim of his bathtub talking to my father for 25 minutes while my father was in the ceiling working on some stuff.
I love that.
While my father stood on his toilet bowl. How many people can claim that? All right, the next movie is probably the one that probably will win the Oscar for Best Picture, Oppenheimer.
Yeah. I think you're right. I think that's where the smart money is betting right now. Hollywood loves to make everybody think that they're very intellectual and that they're very serious. And I think that this is an intellectual and serious movie, of course, based on, again, another movie about a great man that spends a lot of time on his love life. I thought it was a brilliant film. But I will say, I think Christopher Nolan, the director, his films always have kind of a chilly feeling to me. They're very cerebral. They don't have a lot of heart. And he's terrible with his women characters. But so is Oppenheimer. So that works well for this movie.
I'll tell you what I didn't like about the film. And this kind of ruined it for me. They didn't stop with the music. The music was underneath the entire film.
Yeah.
And I don't know.
It was intrusive.
And it was very intrusive. It was loud. Yeah. So much so, I had to cover my ears at one point because the music was bothering me so much that it just, I couldn't deal with it anymore. And it ruined the movie for me. Otherwise, you know, how did a guy like Cillian Murphy lose his accent for this film? How do they do that?
Isn't that funny? Well, I won't let you say lose his accent. He switched accents.
Right, switched accents, yes.
Everybody's got some kind of an accent. But that, you know, those British people and Irish, I have to say, for Cillian Murphy. I mean, Callum Turner, you just saw him in Boys in the Boat. He's English. I interviewed him, and he just did a terrific American accent. I love accents, and I'm always just so impressed by how well they do.
Well, I have a thick New York accent when I'm not on the radio. And some people say, well, do you sound kind of East Coast-ish? How did you lose it? I can't tell you how.
Yeah.
You know, when I'm talking to people, my friends in New York, it comes out like newspaper. I'm reading the newspaper, and I found this thing the other day.
Uh-huh.
But when I'm on the radio, you don't do that.
You don't hear it. No. Right.
That Oppenheimer, it's a great movie, and Hollywood loves these big epic-type films.
They do. As I said, they like people to think that they're serious and intellectual. And so I think Oppenheimer probably going to win Best Picture.
We talked about, before we went on the air, that Godzilla Minus One. Monster movie from Japan.
The Oscar-nominated Godzilla Minus One.
And its prequel, Oppenheimer. Because for people that know the background of Godzilla, that's how he was formed, by the atomic bomb being dropped on Japan. So, and the prequel, I love that. Past Lives. Never heard of this movie before.
Well, that's a little independent film that is about a happily married woman of Korean heritage who meets up with her first love. And even though she's happily married, she wonders what her life might have been like if she had stayed in Korea. And it's just sort of what I call a mood piece. And beautiful performances by everybody. And again, the Hollywood likes to nominate some of these little movies to show that they've got some range. But I don't think it has a prayer of getting any kind of awards.
Just nice to be nominated, though. That's what they always say, don't they?
Yeah, you want to watch the Independent Spirit Awards, and you'll see. I bet it'll pick up an award or two there.
And when we come back, I'm going to tell you about a movie that won the Academy Award for Best Picture that I had never heard of before, but I've seen it four times since because I can't stop watching it. It's that good.
Okay.
And I'll tell you about that coming up. Mel Minow, the movie mom, is here. We're talking about the Academy Award nominations. She's seen them all. You have to pay to go to the movies?
No.
just curious, that's all.
I get paid to go to the movies.
Oh, that's good. That's even better. Nell Minow, we're more coming up here at WRJ, and I'm Don Rosen. It is 729 at Civic Media's WRJN Hometown Radio Refreshed. Nell Minow, the movie mom, is here at moviemom.com. Also, check her out on Facebook. That's where I see her movie reviews there. And we're talking about the Academy Award nominations. Next one on the list, Nell, is a movie that I'm hearing nothing but great things about. Our regular movie guy who comes in every Friday morning, Brett Hoffman from Marcus Theaters, talked about this film before it was even nominated. Poor Things.
Yeah, this is not for everybody, okay? This is rated crazy movie. Think about sort of a Frankenstein story. A pregnant woman commits suicide. The mad doctor implants the brain of her fetus into her head. So she's a grown woman with the brain of a baby and learning about life very, very quickly and immediately discovering physical pleasure, which becomes a big issue over the rest of the movie. You will not guess from one scene to the next what is happening. Emma Stone gives an insanely good performance. As I said, not for everybody. A lot of people are going to be offended by it, but in terms of just being outrageously creative and imaginative, this is definitely at the top of the list.
That's really the plot to the movie?
that's just the beginning. It gets really crazy after that.
Whoa. The Zone of Interest, a film I never heard of.
Zone of Interest, again, Hollywood likes to pat itself on the back for being sophisticated and serious, and it's a Holocaust movie where you never see the concentration camp. It is about the life, the very, very lush, luxurious life of the commander of the concentration camp and their beautiful home on the other side of the wall. And occasionally you'll see smoke going up on the other side of the wall, or you'll get intimations of what's really happening on the other side. But it's, you know, it's about the nature of evil, really, and our inability to compartmentalize ourselves no matter how hard we try. So that's a tough one to watch.
You know, I mentioned off the air to you that the best picture of the year a couple of years ago during COVID was Nomadland. Never heard of it before, and I watched it four times. That's how much I loved that movie. And there's a movie nobody's ever heard of, Nomadland.
And it did get an Oscar, but
but nobody's heard of it before.
Yeah, it's a small movie and a very, 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 very touching one. And Frances McDormand is amazing in it.
Yeah,
it's got such a natural feeling. You almost feel like you're in the room where it's all happening.
Now, you had some disappointments this year. Disappointments don't mean the worst picture of the year. It just means you hoped for more and you got less. So what were your disappointments this year?
Well, there were movies that, you know, looked like they were going to be great on paper and really, I thought, were just terrible. One was, I'm hoping you've never even heard of any of them. One was Paint, with Owen Wilson playing a Bob Ross type TV art
guy. I did hear about it. He had the Afro wig and everything.
Yeah, it was just terrible. Mafia Mama with Toni Collette was just so disappointing. I love Toni Collette. Strays with the talking dogs that had Will Ferrell and Jamie Foxx.
Yes.
And the entire movie was just dogs talking dirty. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. And then there were two science fiction movies that I was really hoping for good things from. One was called FOE, and the other was called Creator. And interestingly, they were both set in the same year of 2065. And both of them, I thought, were very, very disappointing. FOE, had an incredible cast. There are only three characters in the movie. But Saoirse Ronan and Paul Mescal, two amazing actors, and the script just completely let them down. Paul Mescal, by the way, in All of Us Strangers with Andrew Scott and Claire Foy from the Crown, is just an extraordinary film that did not get any Oscar nominations, but definitely worth seeing. It's about a lonely writer whose parents were killed in a car accident when he was just 11 years old, and he has an impulse to go and see his old house, the house that he lived in with his parents, and he goes, and there they are, exactly as they were the last time he saw them, and he gets to have a conversation with them as an adult about his life, and it's very touching. Whether it's really happening or all in his head, the movie doesn't worry about that too much, but it's very, very touching, and this all happens as he's starting to fall in love with another man who lives in his apartment building. And it's that Paul Mescal, definitely watch him, as he's going to be one of the biggest stars of the year anytime now.
Every time we have the Academy Award nominations come out, they talk about the biggest snubs.
Yeah.
So what's the biggest snub you can think of from this year?
Well, I think most people are mad that Margot Robbie did not get an acting nomination and Greta Gerwig did not get a directing nomination. I would love to have seen that, but there are only so many places on there, and it's hard to say who you would knock off to put them on.
You know what Margot Robbie was very good in, and I don't think she got a nomination for it, was Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, the movie about the Manson murders.
She was great playing Sharon Tate. Yeah, she was terrific in that.
And I suggest, it's a Quentin Tarantino film. It's one of my favorites. Leonardo DiCaprio's in there. It's about the Manson murders, but it's not what you think.
It's about the era of the Manson murders,
right,
really. And remember, the Quentin Tarantino is not a historian. He doesn't. But I thought that was a terrific film. And, of course, Brad Pitt deservedly got an Oscar for that one.
And what's really good is, if you're into movies, it is a very good movie lover's film. because they take you into the world of movies.
Well, and it takes place in the year where I was writing movie reviews for my high school paper, and it really brought back a lot of memories.
Was it The Seven Fists of McCluskey in that film? So that's a good movie. One of my big disappointments this year was Priscilla. After you get the Austin Butler Elvis movie, which was very good, then you get Priscilla, the story from Priscilla Presley's point of view, just horrible.
Yeah, I agree with you. You know, I've given up on Sofia Coppola. I feel like she makes these very claustrophobic films about young women who don't have any control over their lives, and I just don't get it. I really it's too bad, because I thought she had such an auspicious debut with Lost in Translation, and I just haven't connected to any of her films since.
What's the first movie you ever saw?
Snow White, the Disney Snow White.
Which is now out on 4K, believe it or not.
Yeah, I know, and I still love it, and I remember very well, and my father wrote a letter to his father, to my grandfather, and he said, we just took Nell to her first movie, and now she wants to go to movies every day, so see, nothing has changed.
A monster was created. and, of course, Whistle While You Work.
Yeah, that's right.
The Seven Dwarves. Yeah, that was a good movie. I can remember every single movie I've seen ever.
Wow.
And the theaters that I saw it in.
Wow.
How do you like that?
That's pretty great.
The first movie I ever saw when I was a little kid was Tammy and the Bachelor. It was at a drive-in movie. I didn't pick the movie. I was a little kid. I was in the car.
Right, of course.
Tammy and the Bachelor with Debbie Reynolds playing Tammy. That was the first movie.
And a classic song.
I see the cottonwoods from spring above.
Tammy.
Which led to a bunch of bad Tammy movies after that.
Yeah.
With Tammy and the Doctor.
Yeah.
Tammy goes to surf and Gidget, and I don't know.
Yeah.
But that's the first one I ever saw. But my favorite movies, my mom used to, I lived in New York, and we used to go to the Cinerama Theater all the time on Broadway.
Mm-hmm.
And we saw some of the big, I remember, we saw It's a Mad, 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 Mad World at the Cinerama Theater.
I saw that one at a drive-in. It was, I still love that movie.
I got the Criterion Edition on Blu-ray.
Good for you.
What a fabulous movie. And people knocked it like it was fabulous.
That movie.
Yeah. We saw Krakatoa, East of Java. We saw Ice Station Zebra, 2001 A Space Odyssey. I remember when we saw 2001 A Space Odyssey in Cinerama. My dad went to the lobby and we're looking at the movie poster they had. He said, what was this all about? It was an interesting movie. I read the Roger Ebert review and when he analyzed 2001, and now it started to make some sense to me.
But it's some sense.
But it's an interesting movie to watch, 2001. And, of course, How the West Was Won and the wonderful world of the Brothers Grimm. Of course,
my dad took me, just me, to see the wonderful world of the Brothers Grimm, and I still love it with Russ Tamblyn and Yvette Mimieux, and,
what's really interesting, when Turner Classic Movies shows How the West Was Won and the wonderful world of the Brothers Grimm, they showed in that smile box format.
Yeah.
Which replicated the big Cinerama screen and the three projectors showing it on that big 150-degree curved screen.
Yeah.
And it brings back a lot of memories seeing those big Cinerama movies. I have all the travelogues on Blu-ray, too, all the ones they ever shot. This is Cinerama, and I love watching those movies. Let's talk about some actors here in the category. Bradley Cooper, Colman Domingo, I never heard of him. I never heard of the film Rustin, either. Got Paul Giamatti, Cillian Murphy for Oppenheimer, and Jeffrey Wright, who you loved for American Fiction. What is Rustin? I never heard of that movie.
Well, Rustin is the story. It was produced by, you haven't heard of the movie, you've heard of the producers. The producers are Barack and Michelle Obama. And it's the true story of one of the great civil rights leaders whose story has kind of been forgotten because he was gay. And so he got pushed to the side of history. But he was the guy who came up with the idea of the March on Washington, the one where Martin Luther King made his famous speech. And Colman Domingo, who's also in The Color Purple, which I wish had gotten some nominations, more nominations, it only got one, is just terrific in the lead role.
Now, you're talking about the Broadway musical version of The Color Purple.
Right, exactly, which is now a movie,
Okay, so in that category, there's a lot of good actors in there, a lot of good people. Cooper, you've got Giamatti, Murphy, and you're picking Jeffrey Wright?
If it was up to me, it would be Jeffrey Wright, but I think it will go Cillian Murphy, and yeah. I think that's fine. He did a great job.
All right, Annette Bening for Naiad. There's a film I never heard of before. You also got Lily Gladstone for Killers of the Flower Moon, Sandra Hüller for Anatomy of a Fall, Carey Mulligan for Maestro, and Emma Stone for Poor Things. I didn't see the other films, but just Lily Gladstone was just so good in that film.
I think she's a sure bet. I want to point out that Sandra Hüller, who you never heard of, is in two of the films nominated for Best Picture because she's also in Zone of Interest. So she's somebody to keep an eye on. I would love to see Emma Stone win, but she's already got an Oscar, and I think this is Lily Gladstone's year. And I do want to recommend Naiad. Naiad is, again, a true story. It's on streaming about Diana Naiad, who in her...
The swimmer.
I think it was in her 50s, decided she was going to swim from Florida to Cuba.
Right. Best Supporting Actor got Sterling K. Brown for American Fiction, Robert De Niro, Killers of the Flower Moon, Robert Downey Jr. for Oppenheimer, Ryan Gosling for Barbie, and Mark Ruffalo, who's from Kenosha, right down the block from us here, for Poor Things. So who's your pick there?
I got to go with Robert Downey Jr. I thought he was absolutely terrific in Oppenheimer.
He's in the black and white scenes.
Yeah.
The newsreel footage in Oppenheimer.
Playing kind of the nemesis of Oppenheimer. Yeah. I thought he was just terrific. I didn't even realize it was him at first.
Yes, he's unrecognizable in that film.
Yeah.
Best Supporting Actress, Emily Blunt for Oppenheimer, Danielle Brooks for The Color Purple, America Ferrera for Barbie, Jodie Foster, who I didn't know was back in acting again for Naiad, and Divine Joy Randolph for The Holdovers.
Definitely Divine Joy Randolph. Definitely Divine Joy Randolph, although that is, of course, a very, very, very good group.
I think I'm losing your phone there for a second. Yeah.
I lost you for a second, but then you came back, so I'm hoping you can hear me.
Yeah, you're all breaking up there for a second. I'm going to have to call you back during the break, which is coming up.
Okay.
Yeah, because it's all breaking up now, and that's the technology of phones, I guess, huh? All right, we're talking to Nell Minow, the movie mom, and we've got another category, Best Director, which is really important. We'll talk about Best Director coming up in just a moment, and I want to talk about her dad, Newton Minow, in just a moment here at WRJN. Hometown Radio Refreshed, a civic media station at 7:48. Stay right where you are. You remember what movie that was featured in?
That was Working Girl.
Working Girl, played at the end of the movie. Over the credit. What a great movie that was, too.
That was a great movie.
You know, every time I think about these films, I say, I got to watch that again.
Yeah.
And God bless Turner Classic Movies for running those movies commercial-free, unedited.
They're the best.
24/7. I mean, I can't believe that Discovery was thinking of doing away with it in some way, shape, or form.
Hollywood stepped in big time.
The biggest director stepped in and said, you're not touching this.
Spielberg,
They did get rid of one of my favorite things where they ran the crazy movies on Friday, Saturday night.
Yeah.
Yeah, the underground films. I wish they would have kept that. Let's talk about best director here. We got some good ones here. I don't know how to pronounce his name for Anatomy of a Fall. Is it Justine? The woman's name, Justine Triet? Is that how you say it?
I think that's right, yeah.
Okay, so you don't know. That's good. Martin Scorsese, Killers of the Flower Moon. Christopher Nolan for Oppenheimer. Yorgos Lanthimos. Is that how you say his name for Poor Things?
That'll do.
And Jonathan Glazer for The Zone of Interest. You're looking for Scorsese. He just made the record for the most nominations of any director ever, right?
Yeah, and, he deserves it every time. But I think they're going to give it to Christopher Nolan.
Yeah.
And I'll tell you how you'll know where it's going to go. When the Directors Guild gives out their awards, it's always the same one because it's the same people who vote. So watch that space.
I want to talk for a moment about your dad, Newton Minow. Oh. Now, he just passed away last year, I think it was, right?
Yes, last May.
How old was he?
97.
Whoa. He's seen a lot in his lifetime.
Yeah.
Now, Newton Minow, for a lot of people that don't know, the name may sound familiar. He has a very famous quote attributed to him. But he was appointed by President John F. Kennedy to be the commissioner for the Federal Communications Commission, which is the highest job you can have in communications. I mean, you control basically how TV, radio, and back then, especially in the early 60s, how TV and radio are going to behave themselves. And we've had, since I've been here at WRJN, we've had two inspections by the FCC. And it's kind of nerve-wracking when they come in, because they come in with their clipboard, and they don't smile. They don't talk. They just show up at your door, and they come during business hours, and you walk them around, and blah, blah, blah. But your dad was made commissioner of the FCC. How did John F. Kennedy come to know your dad?
Well, they've known each other for many years. My father, twice in his life, befriended a young man who later became president, because Barack Obama actually met Michelle when Barack Obama was an intern, a summer intern in my dad's office, and they assigned Michelle to be his supervisor. And my parents ran into the Obamas on their first date when they were at the movies. They went to see Do the Right Thing, the Spike Lee movie. But he met Kennedy when he was working in the presidential campaign of Adlai Stevenson, and liked him very much. And he actually was Bobby Kennedy's roommate on that campaign. Bobby Kennedy was also working on the campaign for Adlai Stevenson, and they got very close. And Dad was only 34 years old when he was made chairman of the FCC, and gave his famous speech. Before that, everybody at the FCC had always been very cozy with the broadcast industry, had always gone to work in that industry afterward. And my dad told the broadcasters, if they didn't do better, he was going to yank their licenses. And he was responsible for the launch of the first telecommunications satellite, for the creation of PBS and the funding for Sesame Street, and the presidential debates, among many, many other things that he did. And we're very proud of him. And he was the world's best dad.
But he is known for a very famous quote. And when people think of Newton Minow, they think of his quote as saying, TV is a vast wasteland, which is true.
It is true. He did say, when television is good, nothing is better, but when it's bad, nothing is worse, and much of it is a vast wasteland, and he is known for that. And Sherwood Schwartz, the television producer, was so angry that my dad said that he named the sinking ship on Gilligan's Island
the Minow.
After him. Minow would be lost.
The SS Minow on Gilligan's Island. That was named after your dad, huh?
It was. We're very proud of that.
Look at that. That is great trivia. Here's something else interesting about the opening of Gilligan's Island for the first season. Mm-hmm. If you watch carefully, there's a flag at half staff in the background because it was filmed right after John F. Kennedy was assassinated.
Oh, my goodness.
And there's an American flag at half staff. And you don't really look, you're not looking at it, but it's there. Here's something else I saw. They filmed the movie Baby, the Rain Must Fall in Texas with Steve McQueen and Lee Remick. Mm-hmm. And when John F. Kennedy was assassinated, they were in the middle of filming, and there's a still shot of them gathered around a car radio, and you could see the look of horror on Lee Remick's face and Steve McQueen, like, holding his chin. They can't believe what he just heard. And it was that moment when they snapped a picture, but Lee Remick has this look of, with her eyes wide open, and she's gasping for air. You could see it when she heard that. But that's, you know, they captured that moment right there. Somebody had the wherewithal to take a picture of it, and now it's preserved. So how long was your dad commissioner of the FCC chairman?
2.5 years.
Boy, he got a lot done in 2.5 years.
He got a lot done. He had three goals, and he got them all done. Creation of PBS, the launch of the telecommunications satellite, and the requirement that all televisions had to have full spectrum, so UHF and VHS. And he did all of that, and then we went back to Chicago. My dad was from Wisconsin. He grew up in Milwaukee.
Yeah, he's born in Milwaukee. That's right about 15 minutes from where, actually, the station broadcast in Milwaukee. So how old were you? You were around when your dad was...
Yeah, I was 9 when he was appointed, and it was an extremely exciting time. I got to meet President Kennedy and Mrs. Kennedy and even Eleanor Roosevelt, and it was a very exciting time to be in Washington as a child.
Do you know, in our lobby, just not more than 25 steps from where I'm standing right, sitting right now, is a picture of Eleanor Roosevelt in front of a WRJN microphone with the mic flag.
Oh, my.
Right underneath the picture is the actual mic flag we have on display in our lobby. That's in the picture.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Eleanor Roosevelt. Unfortunately, somebody threw out the microphone. It was here a couple of years ago.
Mm-hmm.
But they threw it out. But there she is in front of the WRJN mic flag, and you can actually touch that mic flag in our lobby. We actually have the original document of when this station went on the air as WRRS, I think it was, back in 1926.
Mm-hmm.
And the original document, there was no Federal Communications Commission then. It was the Department of Commerce that actually was responsible for radio stations. And that's kind of interesting, the original documents sitting right there. We turn 100 in 2 years, so we're gathering all these documents. Nell Minow, the Movie Mom, moviemom.com. Follow her on Facebook. I like when you do the A-plus and B-minuses of movies. I think that's great. And you recommend the ages for children as well, what they could see. I need you back here after the Oscars.
All right.
To tell me,
deal.
To tell me. Now, I wrote down exactly what you said, who's going to
okay.
win. So I'm going to hold you to it. Now, hold on. Don't go anywhere. Stay right where you are a second. All right. What a great hour. I could do 6 hours with Nell Minow because I love movies so much. You keep it right here. WRJN Radio. Hometown Radio. Refreshed a civic media station at 7:59. Catch you tomorrow morning, 6 a.m. Bright and early. And we have more tickets to give away tomorrow to the Wisconsin State Fair concert of Lauren Daigle, appearing live on Friday, August 9th. Your chance to win tickets again tomorrow morning right here. WRJN.